Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Badr Aljohani. I'm going to talk today about the analytical techniques for tracking counterfeit and substandard medicines. I'm going through a brief introduction about the generic and the counterfeit, also the method of hunting counterfeit, bioequivalence, analytical methods used, results and conclusion. The brand drug, it's going through a long process. A lot of drug companies know that. It may take up to 15 years for a drug to be released in the market. It's going through a lot of clinical trials to prove the efficacy, the quality, and the safety. For the generic one, it depends on the brand, documentation, and label. And the bioequivalence study must be done for the generic. And for substandard copy, it also depends on the brand medication, but there is no bioequivalence test, and it might be with the variable or poor quality. For the counterfeit, there is no data available. It's from unknown origin and composition. They usually say it's from Canada, but there is no proof. And all these products supposed to be legally approved. The counterfeits, it's not, it's illegal, but the substandard copy. This is what the problem we have with the substandard copy, because it's available in the market, in the pharmacies, and in the hospitals. Here's some good publication about the deadly world of falsified and substandard medicine. And another recent publication about substandard in British Medical Journal, substandard and falsified medicine in the UK. Also a recent study in British Journal of Clinical Pharmacology about the substandard drugs. It's really considered a worldwide problem. It affects both developed and developing countries. In May 2014, Interpol reported that during a single week, they seized 9.4 million doses. That's in a single week. So imagine what this number will be in a month or a year. And it contains a lot of, including cancer medications, erectile dysfunction pills, also anti-malarial and cholesterol medications. And they're making a lot of profit from this. Here we have another example from West Africa. It's a TV report called The Traders of Fake Medicines as a Traders of Death. Some fake medicines cause blindness and death in some patients. And the health professionals, they said the responsibility falls on the government and the pharmaceutical agents and the health authorities. And they said also the reasons for smuggling, poor drug availability, no alternative, and the high prices of the medications. Other examples from UK, in 2013, 150,000 of diazepam tablets seized. In France, Cialis and Viagra. In Czech as well. And here we have an example from USA in 2012, also in 2013, fake anti-cancer drug found in a clinic. And you can see the package here and the vial look really genuine. But the FDA confirmed that it contained no active ingredients in it. This is an email I received in my junk folder. I think most of you have such an email, selling some men's sex health and antibiotics and cholesterol lowering agents. Because the online pharmacy is considered one of the main sources of purchasing medication, it was revealed that out of survey of more than 3,000 online pharmacies, only 4 were certified through the verified internet pharmacy practice. Many factors encouraging the spread of counterfeit. Of course, the first factor, the profit they are making from selling this medication. Also, the weak supervision from authorities, lack of drug availability, no good manufacturing practice, and lack of regulation, especially in the free trade zones. And the storage condition may affect the drug as well. For the pharmaceutical bioequivalence, when you are comparing a generic to a brand one, it must be the same in strength, also in the dosage form, active ingredient, and the route of administration. But it could be variable in fillers, binder, excipients, shape, and color. And you can see here the different lisinopril we collected. It's with different colors and some of them with undissolved excipients. Methods used for detecting counterfeit, simple methods, visual inspection. You can check the vial or the package. And if you are suspicious about anything, you can go for further analysis. Also the spectroscopy, the microscopy, and the separation techniques which we used here, including the capillary electrophoresis, HPLC, and mass spec. The first medication, we used the CE with lisinopril, the capillary electrophoresis method, which is an ACE inhibitor used for treat hypertension and heart failure and MI. In 1997, Alfrazima and Perret developed a CE method to analyze complex urines and other unknowns. Cyclodextrin are a powerful modifiers of CE separation. With low wavelength, UV, sulfated beta-cyclodextrin can separate and detect both charged and uncharged species at the same time. I'm going fast through the methods used because we have many of them. This is the CE method. You can see the capillary and the buffer used, the voltage applied. This is a 3D view of the standard lisinopril from 0 milligram up to 1 milligram. And you can see the calibrations for the standard here. Here you can see the spectra of the lisinopril, which is really characteristic. 44 lisinopril obtained for inclusion in this study, two brands from AstraZeneca in UK and Egypt, and 42 other generics from various sources in Asia, Europe, and Africa. Here you can see a chromatogram showing the lisinopril peak and the impurity. This is a brand from UK. You can see the spectra of lisinopril, also the spectra of the impurity. Here another generic with lower impurities in it. Here the brand from Egypt, also with low impurity. And here we have a really poor quality with many impurities detected in it. Here you can see the results of the percentage of impurities detected in each product, and it may reach up to 27% of the medication. This CE method offered an excellent approach of separation of drug and unknown impurities in brand, generic, and counterfeit. It's not compound specific due to low wavelength detection, but it's simple compared to the LC. Also, it's fast and cheap. For cyclosporin, we use the HPLC. Cyclosporin is an immunosuppressant with narrow therapeutic window. I think most of you know what narrow therapeutic means, thin line between the therapeutic effect and the toxic effect. It used for the prevent of transplant rejection, also used for the immune diseases such as rheumatoid arthritis and psoriasis. HPLC provides an excellent technique for measuring average drug content in tablets and capsules. This study described the development, validation, and application of HPLC method for the determination of cyclosporin. And the products obtained 5 brands from Europe, Asia, Africa, and 3 generic from South America, Asia, and Africa. This is the HPLC method used. JASCO system with the C18 column. Aceto of the mobile phase, acetonitrile and water, the flow rate 0.7 mils per minute, and the detection was over 25 minutes. Also, a dissolution test done for the cyclosporin capsules according to the USP guidelines using this machine. And the sampling time was from 5 minutes up to 2 hours. Here you can see a typical chromatogram showing cyclosporin standard from 0.1 milligram up to 2 milligrams. And the standard curve with good R square. And here the results of the medication we use. All the medications met the USP requirement for a dissolution, which is the capsule must be ruptured within 15 minutes. So all of them met the USP requirement for the dissolution. But for the content, we can see here most of the brand and generic met the USP requirement, which is should be 80% of the drug should be dissolved after 90 minutes. Except for this one. And you can see here the percentage of the drug dissolved, and it's variable, it's varied even between the brand itself. This brand from different countries, and you can see it's from 84 up to 99%. And this one, this generic, it's written in the package 100 milligram of cyclosporin. And we found only 54% of the active ingredients in it. I don't know what this one should be considered, substandard or counterfeit, but it was available in a pharmacy, in a street. The HPLC study represents a simple, rapid, and specific, also sensitive method for detecting the for determination of immunosuppressive cyclosporin. It also showed that some cyclosporin capsules contain lower than label amount. According to the USP, a minimum 80% of label amount should be dissolved in 90 minutes. We go for further analysis of cyclosporin capsules to detect the impurities. We used this nanoacuity UPLC with the micromass QTOF to detect the impurities in the cyclosporin capsules. And here you can see a chromatogram showing an example of a clean product with a clear cyclosporin peak at 12 minutes and small impurity at 8 minutes. And here a poor product with a small peak of cyclosporin at 12 minutes and high impurity at 9 minutes. And one of the major impurities we found, it's a degradation, cyclosporin degradation product. For azithromycin, we used, it's a macrolide antibiotic. It's used to treat some bacterial infections such as pneumonia, gonorrhea, infections of lung. Both brand and generics are available worldwide in different dosage forms. Late in 2013, FDA issued a warning about the possible fatal effect of azithromycin due to abnormalities in cardiac electrical activity. Okay. These are the conditions used for the separation. UPLC mass spec used for quantitation of the azithromycin. Here a chromatogram showing the peak of the azithromycin and the internal standard. And most of the tablets in this study met the USP requirement, which is also 80% of the drug should be dissolved in 30 minutes in azithromycin, except for this one, which is less than the minimum amount. In conclusion, we can say the CE, HPLC, and the mass spec proved suitable approaches for analysis of drugs and their unknown impurities in brand generic and counterfeit medicines. CE with UV detection is not a compound specific, while LCMS is a highly specific, so the techniques are complementary. So whenever you are taking a medication, should you ask yourself, is it fake or not? You should find an analyst. I would like to thank my colleague, Dr. Ghazali, and my professors, David Perrett and Athol Johnson. Also, I would like to thank AstraZeneca for providing the reference standard of cyclosporin. Thank you, everybody. Pharmacopoeia, you mean? This is the current scenario, what I mentioned. For the cyclosporin? Yeah, it's the same, still the same. You are not allowed to ask questions because of sore throat. Go ahead, Jessica.
that HPLC peak.
Yeah. It could be, because that was measured for the lisinopril, you mean. That was measured with the CE. CE cannot identify what kind of impurities. So it's, you can detect with the CE, but you don't know what's the impurity. It could be an excipient, could be whatever. But if you go for further analysis, like the mass spec, you can identify what's the exact impurity. Is it a degradation? Is it an excipient or... Diode array, yeah. Sometimes it must, it, but you know, the, for the to know what the unknowns is, you have, I think you have to pay more money. Go for mass spec or, you know.
Because in UPPs there's not, sometimes the false result for the contaminant, but if we use the diode array detection, this is the...
Yeah, exactly, yes. Yeah.
So what's the answer here? Have you looked at any? Have you looked at maybe 10 random samples of a conventional drug from a well-known pharmacy?
Yeah. You mean
just as a routine sample, see if the conventional over-the-counter or pharmaceutical drugs are safe or real?
Actually, sometimes for what I mentioned, the storage condition may affect. Maybe storage condition may affect even in the street pharmacy or anywhere. If they are not stored properly, maybe the drug will be degraded and it affect, you will not take the good effect from the medication. But when you are talking about medications such as cyclosporin, it's really critical. You use the cyclosporin for treating the transplant patients. And the last thing you want, a rejection of the organ when you are using such a medication. So it must be at least an analytical unit in the hospital or with the health authorities to examine these products before giving it to the patients.
That bevacizumab bottle you showed came from a hospital. How could that have happened?
Sorry?
The bevacizumab, that cancer drug, you said that came from a hospital?
Some of them, for cyclosporin, yeah, obtained from hospital.
No, the cancer drug.
The cancer.
The
bevacizumab. Yeah, it found in a clinic, in a nearby, no, not nearby, it's a far state, in California. Yeah. And it was given to the patient, but it has no effect because the FDA examined the product and they found, I show you the package, it looked really genuine from Roche, but it discovered that it came from, I think, Turkey or something. Yeah. Yeah, also this medication, it was, the FDA discovered in 2012, and it was also again discovered in 2013. I don't know if it's the same Avastin or another product, but another anti-cancer medication was discovered here in the United States.
Okay.